Good morning, everyone. It is so good to join together here in-house or on the stream. The Lord is near unto all who call upon him. If we're going to call upon him. He is the great I am. Let's sing a song. I've been the one to shake with fear and wonder if you're even here. I've been the one to doubt your love. I've told myself you're not enough. Trust in you as well. Will you stand if you can, please? In this next song, we're going to ask and answer a bunch of very important questions. So sing along. Mm-hmm. Do you feel the world is broken? Do you feel the shadows deepen? And do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? Do you wish that we could see it all made new? Well, is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who has conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of our blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is. Does the Father truly love us? Does the Spirit move among us? And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves? Does our God intend to dwell again with us? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom of priests to our God, to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of our blessing, honor, and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? He is. He is. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is. Lord God, you are worthy, and it stirs our hearts just to sing those words together, to hear one another sing. And often we can come to worship or come to you and feel unworthy, but when we get in your presence, you restore us. You are ever interceding for us, Lord, to draw us close to you. So we ask that you would bless this worship and everyone in attendance. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, worship team. Good morning. You may be seated. I'm Pastor Gibbs. If you're wondering who I am, maybe you can't tell from behind the mask. Welcome to worship. Welcome to those of you on the stream as well. We're glad to have you all with us here today. I'm running just a little bit behind. We had a really good new members and inquirers class at 9:30 this morning. And so we just got to talking, and next thing I know, I look at my watch, and it was 10:25. So thank you for being here, and I know I didn't have all my housekeeping done, but thanks for enduring that. Just a couple announcements here this morning. First of all, on your way out of church this morning, make sure you look at that tree out in the courtyard there through the windows. The tree is just blossoming. It's just beautiful. The second thing is, with respect to my new members or inquirers class, if any of you are new members or are just a visitor or a guest looking for some information about St. Michael and what our ministry is about here, feel free to come and join us next week. It's at 9:30. We meet back in the junior high classroom back there, and I think that's the east side of the building. So it's just down this hallway here, and then you just turn to the left. All right, I think that's all the announcements I have for today. We will be taking Holy Communion later in the service. If you're a guest or a visitor among us, feel free to come and join us at the Lord's table this morning. All right, well, last week, you may have noticed on the top of my sermon notes that I handed out to you that there was a verse there, a memory verse. And I forgot to have you start memorizing that last week, so we're going to do it this week. All right, so if you have today's sermon notes, it's also at the top of that sermon note sheet as well. But I want you to recite this with me, if you would, please. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. Let's do that again. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. That is Psalm 27, verse 8. I want to encourage you to take your sermon notes home and use this verse in your quiet time, in your devotional time this week. Be reciting that verse, be memorizing that verse, because in the next week or two, I'd like to get you to the where you have that totally memorized, totally internalized into your life, okay? All right, well, we are talking about seeking the Lord. I started talking about that last week, and I mentioned last week that there are at least three ways by which the Bible says you can seek God and find him. And I mentioned last week, and I talked a little bit about meditating on the Word of God. So that's the first way that you can seek out God, and God promises when you do that, you will find him. So number one, by meditating on the Word of God. The second way is what I'm going to talk about today, and that is seeking God in worship. Okay, by worshiping God, you can seek God and find him. And finally, the third way, I'll talk about this next week, you can seek God by serving him, by serving God. Okay, so let's talk about worship today. And I want to do that by using as my message scripture today, Psalm 63, 1-5. You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you. In a dry and parched land where there is no water, I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. In my Bible, at home, right next to this scripture passage, at some time in the past, I wrote David's passion for God. David's passion for God. The word passion is the word that came to mind when I first read this Psalm 63. I still feel like that's a really good way to describe what David is feeling here in this psalm. Passion is what David is feeling when in verse 1 he says, I thirst for you, O God. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you, like a person living in a dry, parched land longs for a drink of water. Think about that image. Have you ever been really thirsty and you just couldn't wait to get a drink of water? That's what David is talking about. That's how he feels all the time about God. He just can't get enough of God. How did David get so passionate about God? Well, let me ask you, are you passionate about God? Are you as passionate as David is, or even come close to being as passionate as David does? Well, David tells us in the two verses following verse 1, why he desires God like he does at such a deep level. He says there in verse 2, I have seen you in the sanctuary, O Lord, and I have beheld your power and your glory, and I have discovered that your love is better than life itself. Did you catch that there? God's love, according to David, is better than even life itself. David has come to understand that nothing else matters if you are not honoring and praising and serving God with your life. And this revelation came to him through his lifelong worship of the Lord. And so, let me suggest to you that if we desire to develop a similar love and a similar passion for God as David had, that we too should seek him in worship. Within the Bible, you will find many forms of worship, but they all have the same goal: to provide us with the opportunity to express how we truly feel about God, and to give God an opportunity to communicate with us just how much he loves us. Worship is our response to God's saving actions in our life. It's our response to his sending of his son Jesus to die on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. It's our response to God raising Jesus from the dead, destroying the power of death forever, so that nothing can separate us from God's love. And for the giving of the gift of the Holy Spirit, bringing us God's mercy and wisdom each and every day. That's a lot. I mean, God has done a lot for us, hasn't he? The worship we're most familiar with is what we're doing right now. Public worship. When God's people come together to praise God with one voice. I was just thinking during that last song we just sang here before my message, how beautiful it was for all of us to be singing that song with one voice, lifting it up and just praising God from the depths of our hearts. Our public worship is patterned after Israel's worship in the temple and in the synagogue, and it serves to strengthen the bonds of faithfulness and love between us and God, but also between us and each other. Yet as important as corporate worship is, it's only periodic, isn't it? We only do it, you know, by custom now, about once a week. Some churches might do it twice a week. Most just do it once a week, like we do here. But David knew that worship needed to happen much more often in his life. If he was to really know God at a very deep level, he needed to have worship in his life more often than once a week. And in fact, he needed to engage in worship perhaps continually. Some of his language makes it sound like he is worshiping day and night. Let me share with you some psalms where David shares how he feels about worship. This is Psalm 63:6. On my bed, I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night. This morning, about 5 o'clock, my alarm was supposed to go off a little after 6. And of course, what do? I wake up at 5 o'clock and I can't go back to sleep. You ever have that happen to you? All right. So what I've discovered over the years is that when I wake up like that and I can't go back to sleep, it's usually because God is like slapping me upside the head saying, hey, wake up, I got to talk to you. So I laid there and I prayed. I prayed for a while. I don't think I prayed for the whole hour before my alarm went off. I think I eventually dozed back off. But the point I'm making there is that there are always opportunities. Just like David says, through the night watches, I was thinking of you. That happens to us, doesn't it? We have the opportunity to worship. We have the opportunity to worship during the day. All right? Let's go to the next scripture here. Psalm 42:8. By day, the Lord directs his love, and at night, his song is with me. So David is saying, you know, I am in contact. I am in connection with God throughout the day, worshiping my God. And then at night, the last words on my mouth before I go to sleep are words of prayer and song to my God. So worship was very important to David. It should be very important to us as well. Finally, Psalm 119:97. Oh, how I love your law. I meditate on it all day long. I spent some time last week talking about daily quiet time, about praying and meditating over God's word. And what I want you to understand here about daily personal worship time is that the very act of intentionally carving out time in your day to focus on your relationship with God is in itself an act of worship. Personal daily study of the word, personal daily communication with God through prayer are important acts of worship by which God can reveal to you that he is there, that he is with you, and he can reveal his power to you, and he can reveal his glory to you so that you can take strength and comfort in that fact that he is with you. So you've got public worship, which we're doing now. It's very important. You've got personal, daily, intentional times of worship that you build into your day. Very important. But let me leave you with one more thought about life. This is a something I've learned, was revealed to me by some mentors, very important mentors in my life. And what they taught me is this: life itself can be worship. Life itself should be worship. Life done as God wants you to do it is worship. What you spend your life doing is the best indication of where your loyalties lie. Let me share with you some words from the Apostle Paul. He says here in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in the view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. For this is your true and proper worship. In other words, sacrifice your own will. You know, decide to turn aside from the things that you think that are really important, and seek out God's will for your life and do that. That's the sacrifice that Paul's talking about here, where you give up your own desires and your own wants and your own needs in order to fulfill what God needs and wants from you. That is your sacrifice, and that is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. And I would add the words "for you." You will be able to test and approve what God's will is for you. His good, pleasing, and perfect will. What Paul's really asking here is, who or what is your God? Will you spend this gift of life that God has given to you chasing after idols in your life? Riches, status, control, power, pleasure? Or will you seek to serve God with the gift of time and opportunity with which God has blessed you? That's really the main question of life. Who will you serve? Will you serve the false gods, or will you serve the one true God? Seeking to do God's will in all your life is, according to St. Paul, the best worship we can ever offer to God. What did he say? Was it your true and perfect worship? And in this worship, when you give your life over to that kind of worship, God is able to transform you by the renewing of your mind into the kind of person that God wants you to be. All right, I'm going to close here this morning with another psalm, Psalm 95. And in my Bible, it has a note there that says that this is a call to worship used in the temple. And so as we close here, I want to use this kind of as a doxology. Sorry about that. I've got my finger on the wrong button, going the wrong direction. There we go. Okay, so I want to use this as kind of a doxology to just kind of cap my message here today, and I want you to help me with it. Would you recite this with me, please? Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. Amen. Amen. As we prepare for prayer time, let me begin by asking, do you have any particular joys or victories you'd like to share with the congregation? Yes, Tina. Okay. 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 All right. So the joy is that Ryder has completed his training. Ryder, you're training a service dog named Ryder, and his training is complete. And on Tuesday, he's going to be placed with a new person who will use him in their daily life. And so Ryder will help them in their daily life. And what's the person's name?
Her name is
80. Okay, so he's going to be placed with 80. Okay, so we will definitely pray for them here today. All right, any other prayer requests? Joys? Yes. Yep, they are. They're making the rounds because they were at first service last week, right? So welcome Ted and Jan back from Florida. Glad to have you. Anyone else? Yes. Oh, that's right. Sean, happy birthday. Sean Jennings. Anyone else? Any additions to our prayer list? Yes. Okay. All right, so we're going to pray for Bob and the family and friends of Ken Pickford. Okay. Anyone else? Yes.
My son-in-law, Tom Sorico, had back surgery.
Okay. Okay, we'll pray for Tom, recovery from back surgery. Anyone else? Yes, Sharon.
The Meyer family.
Okay, Meyer family. Okay, I have one here. Yep.
Mike.
Okay, pray for Mike. COVID. Yes. Yeah. Good to have you back.
Thank you.
Yeah. Fully vaccinated, ready to go, right? All right. And also, where's our drummer? She's here, right?
She's here.
Today?
Yeah,
yeah. She must be out of the sanctuary at the moment. But she has not been with us for about a month. So it's great to have Allison back with us. All right. Anything else before we go to prayer? All right. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, gracious Lord, we come together here in public worship, and what a joy it is to come together as the body of Christ, as the people of God, called by God to be his people in the world. We thank you, Lord, for this privilege. We pray, Father, as we come before you, that you will hear our prayers of repentance and that you will forgive us of all of our sins, that you will restore us to a right relationship with you. We pray that through your Son, Jesus, all of our sins will be washed away. We pray that you will help us to walk in the way of Jesus through the power of your Holy Spirit in the days and weeks ahead, that we may take the gospel from this place out into the world, that we may nurture and enlarge your kingdom through our proclamation of the good news of Jesus Christ. So, Lord, inspire us, equip us, and help us to overcome any kinds of fears or concerns or stumbling blocks that we may have from fulfilling this mission. We pray, Father, that you will speak to us each and every day in our quiet time, that as we study your word and as we reflect on it and meditate on it, as we engage you in prayer, Lord, come to us. And as David said there, show us your power and your glory, that we might be prepared and just fortified to go out into the world and to be your people. We pray, Father, that you will teach us through your word how we ought to live. You'll teach us that more excellent way that St. Paul talked about, so that when people look upon us, they can see something there of value. They can see a way of life that offers hope and peace and understanding. And may they grow thirsty for that. May they desire that. And may we, Lord, be fully prepared to give an answer to them as to why we live the way we do and why we believe the way we do and why we walk in the path in which we walk. So bless our efforts. Prosper our efforts, Lord, to be effective witnesses and disciple makers in the world. Lord, we lift up and pray for all of these folks on our prayer list today. We pray for Karen, who's having surgery. We pray for Tom, who is a friend of Lawson Stone, having some medical issues. We pray for Greg, who's recovering from COVID, a friend of Beth Pauley. We pray for Christine Bischoff, who's in the hospital. She'd normally be worshiping with us, but she's having some heart issues, and we'll be having some testing tomorrow. So we lift her up to you, Lord, place her in your hands, and pray that your healing power will anoint her body and keep her safe. We pray for Shirley, Marissa Gill's aunt, found out recently she's going to need surgery for a new heart valve. We pray for Bob. We pray for Tom. We pray for Mike. We pray for the family and friends of Ken Pickford. We pray for the Meyer family. We pray for Ryder as he gets placed with his new person, 80. We pray that they'll develop a strong relationship and that it'll be a blessing for each of them. We pray for Rachel and her unborn baby. We pray for George, who has COVID. We pray for the family and friends of Jim Lindell and the family and friends of Johnny Beck. Lord, hear our prayers for these people that we lift up to you today. Hear our prayers for the people on our prayer list. Hear the prayers for the people that are burdening our hearts. Lord, as we go through our daily lives, we are in contact with people who have special needs, and I know those concerns are there on the hearts of your people here this morning. Hear our prayers for those folks as well. Bring your healing power to bear in our lives, O Lord, however and whatever way, to whatever effect that you desire. We place ourselves totally in your hands. Lord, as we come forward today and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus, may it remind us of his great sacrifice. May it remind us of why we are so committed to following him, because he gave himself up for us. Lord, inspire us to give ourselves up for him. All of this we pray in the name of that same Jesus who is now our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Amen. All right. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Then our Lord Jesus took the cup. He gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, the new testament, the new promise made in my blood. Blood shed for you and all people for the forgiveness of your sins. As often as you drink it, do so in remembrance of me." Will you pray with me the words our Savior taught us? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Ushers, can you come forward? the body of Christ given for you.
In the darkness,
and the blood of Christ shed for you.
Without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running.
The body of Christ given for you.
There was mercy in your eyes. To
the blood of Christ shed for you.
And prophets, to a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory.
The body of Christ given for you. Blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ given
praise
for you.
The Father,
the blood of Christ
praise
shed for
the
you.
The Son, praise
the body of Christ
Spirit,
given for you.
Three
the blood of Christ
one,
shed for you.
God,
the body of Christ
glory,
given for you.
Majesty,
the blood of Christ shed for you.
Praise for
the body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
You sought to the
body of Christ given for you.
Jesus,
the blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ given for you.
Raise the Son. Raise the Spirit.
The blood of Christ shed for you. Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
In the morning,
the body of Christ given
rose,
for you.
All of heaven held it.
The blood of Christ shed for
that
you.
That stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death.
The body
and
of Christ given for you.
From their tombs and the angels.
Blood of Christ shed for you.
Souls who come to the Father are restored. And in the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit is the flame. Now the gospel truth of old shall not mean, shall
that's
not
good.
Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
The body of Christ given for you.
Praise
the blood of Christ shed for you.
Praise
the body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ
praise
shed for you. Now throw them in the trash. Body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
Praise forever to the King of Kings.
The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ given and shed for you. Hang on a second here. There you go. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. the body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Can you commune me? Just commune me. I can use this. That's fine. Yeah, yeah. I can grab that.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Is that everyone? So, okay. Would you please stand if you can? May this, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace now and always. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace now and always. Amen. All right. Well, thank you, everybody, for coming today. It was a joy to be here with you, and I'm going to turn it over to the worship team to send us out. Take it away, guys.
Amen. These are the names of God. The Bible says that the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run in, and they are safe. Such a fun song. The beginning and the ending, the creator. These are the names of God. Mighty warrior, consuming fire, Abba Father. These are the names of God. The Lion of Judah, firm foundation, our high tower. These are the names of God. Gentle whisper, intercessor, he's our helper. Yeah, these are the names of God. There is power in his name, there is healing in his name, there's salvation in his name. Let us sing and salvation. He's our teacher. Oh, these are the names of God. He's our healer. He's our shelter. He's our portion. These are the names of God. There is power in his name. There is healing in his name. There's salvation. There is good shepherd. These are the names of God. It is Jesus, precious Jesus, Lord and Savior. These are the names of God. Amen. Isn't that a fun song? Lord bless you. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The beginning and the ending, the Creator. These are the names of God, mighty warrior, consuming fire, Abba Father. These are the names of God, Lion of Judah, firm foundation, our high tower. These are the names of God, gentle whisper, intercessor, he's our helper. Oh, these are the names of God. There is power in his name, there is healing in his name. There's salvation in his name, let us sing. Redeemer, the rewarder. These are the names of God, man of sorrows, friend of sinners, the good shepherd. These are the names of God. Well, he's the author of salvation, he's our teacher. Oh, these are the names of God. The names of God. Precious Jesus, Lord and Savior.